Today, I'm going to be making several things. So I'm going to start off right away. We're going to do a classic corn casserole. So I'm going to talk and cook at the same time. So right here, I have the pan that I'm going to bake it in, and I'm going to mix it and bake it in the pan that it is in. So the first thing that you do is you take corn. It's usually one can of corn. I'm using frozen, which is perfectly fine. And then I'm using one can of creamed corn. There we go, just put that all in there. This is a classic favorite. And my mother and I were a little worried because we were having a hard time finding creamed corn in the stores, so we were like panicking just a little bit, but the good news is that we have it. Now, here is some cheese, cheddar cheese. I'll leave a little bit for the top so that you can see how beautiful that topping is gonna be. I'm gonna zhuzh it up just a little bit. And then I have two eggs, fresh from the Stralini chicken. She's right in the back, so I've heard. So thank you, chicken, we love you. Anyway, so that's gonna help bind the mixture. And then we'll also add some sour cream. So I'm gonna grab another spoon here. And you need sour cream to make this extra delicious. So there you go. Alrighty. Oh, you know what? The one thing I do need too is I need some butter. So let me get that going. I like to use unsalted butter when I cook because I find that the salt tends to mask any off flavor in the butter. So you can always add your own salt. And when you do that, you actually turn out using less salt than you would have had you used the salt kind. So I will add one box of the gold cornbread mix. We're gonna stir that up a little bit, but I'm gonna add the butter to it as soon as it's melted. So there we go. I'm gonna let that just stir up a little bit. And then I'm gonna cut up some topping to show you how to make things, how to elevate things, make it up a little bit special, a little bit different. So I think the beautiful thing about Thanksgiving is that many of the dishes are extremely simple, and that's a good thing. Where your creativity comes from is that the moment you see me doing something, you know, cooking this basic recipe, and then maybe you're thinking in the back of your mind, well, you know, my mother did it this way, my grandmother did it this way, my aunt or uncle did it this way. That's number one, the bond that you have to cherish and you have to carry on. So, and also you might be thinking, wow, I think it'd be really good with a jalapeno in it. Guess what? You're now a creative cook. How cool is that? So whenever you're cooking, remember to be creative. And I always have this little saying, it's never a mistake. It's just a new recipe. And you know, that kind of takes some of the pressure off as well too. Because I think part of the thing that I love about Thanksgiving so much are the stories. I literally have a story where I was making the dressing. And I got it out of the oven. It was absolutely gorgeous. And I completely dropped it in the sink full of sudsy water. I pulled it out really quick and maybe nobody would notice, but my husband noticed. So there you go. So folks out there, you know, it happens. It happens. So here we go. I've got my butter. I'm going to just put that right in there. You betcha. And give that a stir. I've really enjoyed teaching cooking classes for many years, and I've had a cooking show for many years. So I always tell people a lot of these recipes for Thanksgiving, for television wise, is what I call a dump, stir, and smile. Because you never know when the camera's on you. So here, I'm gonna share all my TV secrets with you guys. So it's never, you know, like, never look like you're bored. Like, oh gosh, you know, like, you gotta dump, stir, and smile. Okay, there you go, see? There you go. You know, these are things that are gonna hopefully get you a million likes, and I'm giving these all to you guys for free. I'm gonna share all my secrets with you. So there you go. Oh my gosh, it smells heavenly. Oh, love it. Okay, so I have some beautiful red bell pepper and green bell pepper that I've cut up. I've lived in Texas for 33 years. Now that I'm back in Michigan, you know, I try to bring a little bit of my Texas, you know, memories with me. My dear friend Lori, who I think is watching tonight, when I worked with her, we would always make cornbread muffins in the shape of Texas, and we would put chopped jalapenos and chopped red bell peppers on top, and it just looks so pretty. So just here is your creativity. If you don't like them, don't worry, it's all good. But here's how you can make it pretty with a little bit of what we call zhuzhing. And then add a little bit of your cheese on top. And you're in good shape. Boy, that looks really pretty. Now, I've been waiting to say this, I think, probably for 33 years, but this is the first time that I've cooked in a magical theater, and the first time that I can really tell you that after about 40 minutes in a 375-degree oven, the magic of television, this is going to be done. So we're actually going to bake this in real time. So how exciting is that? Magic in cooking. It can happen. And it takes a village, that's for sure. All right, I'm going to pass this to the magic turkey elves, and they're going to get that all. How cool is that? You know, there's a... It's so nice to have help in the kitchen, and that's what I encourage you guys to do with your family and friends, because this is a perfect opportunity for them to get excited and learn about cooking and have some fun. All right, I will need this rinsed, thank you very much. And I'm gonna just clean my board. I'm gonna leave that right here. There we go. When you're cooking, try to keep your workspace tidy. And that's a good thing to do. So I think I've got everything that I need there. And when you're working on Thanksgiving too, have a plan. Guess what? I made my plan really simple today. I just took a plate and I wrote it on the plate, because why not? And you could put that on your refrigerator, and then all your friends and family, if they come in saying, hey, what can I help with? Then say, hey, look at the plate, you know, and there you go. So check, we've got the corn stuffing. Now I'm going to work on the regular stuffing. So this is the corn casserole we just did. We're gonna work on the stuffing next. So I'm gonna just shift my board here. This is a little portable burner that I use a lot when I'm on the road cooking. Oftentimes people ask me, they're like, how do you do it? How do you cook on the road? Well, you know, there's so many things that you can use that are really designed for camping, which is really fun. And I don't know why, but food tastes so much better when it's cooked outside. I don't know why. Thank you, my dear. Thank you so much. So I'm just gonna get my burner going on a medium-high temperature, and we're gonna start making that stuffing. So let me get my little magical pile of ingredients. Ah, beautiful. Alrighty, so I'm gonna give you a few little tricks of the trade, a few little secrets from my cooking show that I've learned throughout the years. You know, think about it. The technology is here, and it's so easy for you to tape this at home, what you're doing at home. So here's my homework project for you. I would like for all the moms, the dads, aunts, uncles, grandmas, and grandpas to get your recipe, just one recipe. I'm not asking for the world here. I'm just asking for a little bit of your one of your special recipes that you love to share with your family. Get it set up. And cooking wise, what we call this is, it's called mise en place. So everyone say mise en place. But very good, I heard you all. So mise en place means everything in place. And it, you know, if you think about magic, you know, magicians really, they have to practice and they have to have everything just right. It's not much different in cooking. The magic lies with your mise en place. So have everything ready that you need. All right. So I'm starting this with one stick of butter. Yes, you heard right. And this is just gonna melt. We're gonna saute some onions and celery in there. It's gonna be really good. Aha, make them smoke. This is awesome. So I'm gonna add my onions and celery right there, because it just needs to start cooking, and we don't want it to burn. This burner is really, really hot, so that kind of buffers it just a little bit. So your onions and celery are just gonna cook for about 3 to 4 minutes until they're tender and golden and delicious. My favorite part about the stuffing is that as soon as I get the turkey in the oven, I'm making my stuffing. And you know, for me, when I get the turkey in, I kind of start to relax. I mean, I literally could do the whole Thanksgiving dinner in one morning. So this is my starting point, and I never stress about making Thanksgiving. I get more stressed about doing laundry because I'm not really good at it. You know, I'm here to tell you, it's not my strength. So cooking, yeah, that's easy. Okay, there we go. Now, we're going to just let that cook for a little bit. And you know, if you've got somebody at home that loves to help, then it's a great thing to have them stir. And I might have somebody to help me stir this. So, Shango, would you like to help me on this one, please?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Stir fingers with me, Carol.
You did. Look
yes,
at you. I love it. That's great. Well, many of you may have recognized Shango before. He's cooked with me on his pizza segment, and you're doing great. It's so good to see you.
I'm excited to be here.
All righty. Well, very good. So left. Are you a right-handed or left-handed?
Yes, right-handed.
Right hand. So left hand here. Stir and smile.
Right.
Don't forget the smile. Excellent. Excellent. I'm going to have you scoot over just a little bit, my dear friend. There we go. Yes. Thank you so much. So here we go. How's everybody doing out there? Are you having fun? I hear you. Yay. This is so much fun.
We're having fun here.
We are. We are. Okay. So does it smell good?
Fantastic.
Oh, fantastic, fantastic. So while you're doing that, I'm going to get my apple peel. So I'm going to tell a few little stories now about my husband and I's first Thanksgiving. We had moved down to Texas about 33 years ago from Michigan. We both grew up in Battle Creek, Michigan, and we moved down to Texas to be rock stars. Yes, we did. It didn't quite work out. I became a cook, and my husband and I started producing my cooking show and cooking classes and all of that. So, you know, when we came back here, not many people really know me for cooking. They know me more for wanting to be a rock star, you know, and didn't happen. So I remember the first Thanksgiving we did as honeymooners, and I remember, I don't know how it happened, but I put apple in it, probably because I had apples, and I just decided why not try apples in there. And then, that's how I started. That's how I put the apples in the stuffing. And I think that's a great nod to Michigan, because Michigan apples are amazing. They just really, really are. Knife skill lesson. So remember now, thumb here, index finger here. Try not to put your finger there, because if you do that, you may just like that. You betcha, Shango. That's what's gonna happen, folks. Be careful out there. So you will cut that down, cut it in half, and we'll get the core out. Now, I often cut an apple a night, just about almost every night, and we'll eat it by itself. We'll eat it with a salad. We'll put bananas with it. I love to have an apple, and apples are just so good for you. So it's a good thing to do. So there you go. So if you're holding your knife like that, it becomes an extension of your hand, kind of like a magic wand.
Sure.
You know, you have to hold it like a wand. And then you're going to just cut down like so, and then go across. Now this is the bridge hand. So this hand, you go like this, kind of go up, tilt your little fingers like that. It's not a kneeling hand. It's like a curve. Protect that little thumb. And there you go. But I'm sure that if I lost my thumb, the magic world could produce another one for me.
A lot of them in the shop over there, Carol.
I'm guessing. And I don't know how they work.
Try and make it your thumb.
I love it. Okay. Oh, that's looking great, my friend.
It smells so delicious.
Does it smell good? Mm. Awesome. Turn that down just a little bit. Oh, this is so much fun. The aromas, the textures, the colors, and the flavors. Okay, so I've got my apple in there. I'm going to find some sage. So you stay right there, my friend.
Right.
You're going to be the entertainment value.
We're talking about all those meats. You know, every winter I get a lot of meats in my house.
Oh, you know what? You know what? I think I had that same issue. I did. I mean, I hate to share this story, but I might. I opened this little cupboard, and there was all of the little puppy's dog food in there. And I'm like, what's the dog food doing in the cupboard? Just like all over the place. And we're like, that's funny. And then I discovered later that there were mice in there. So they were taking all of the dog food and putting it away for later. So isn't that funny? So I think we need a cat. So, alrighty. Now I'm going to cut up some fresh sage. Here's some sage advice,
right,
my friend.
Talk to me.
All right, we're going to have. So it's a good idea when you have sage, you want to infuse the flavor of your fresh herbs into the liquid part. That way, whatever they touch is going to have that great flavor of the sage. So you stay right there. I'm going to get a little salt and pepper. and I've been teaching for a million years, so, you know, I have the same shtick all the time. But when you do salt and pepper, I usually use two fingers and a thumb. To me, that's 1/8 of a teaspoon. And if you go straight down, that's where it's going to go, and that's 1/8 of a teaspoon. But if you go up and around, it broadcasts it all over, and you look cool doing it. That's half the battle. So I'm going to do about 4 good, you know, I'll let you do the last one.
Oh, my.
So give me a little salt there, like the Salt Bae. I'm sure you guys have seen him, you know, doing the steaks.
Do I look cool now?
Well, I think so. What do y'all think? Yep, pretty good. There you go, a little salt and pepper.
All right.
Fresh sage. Okay, excellent. So I will now get my broth. Here it is. And I just love going to my mother's house because she sends me home with a box of goodies, and it's always a bargain. She always has the bargains for
sure.
me. So this is from my mom. She sent me home with all this great broth. Don't you love it?
You know, it's a rule whenever you go to your parents' house, whatever is theirs is yours as well, right?
I didn't know that.
It's automatic. You just can have anything.
That's greatness. I love it. I love it. I think I still have one of her salt and pepper shakers from years ago. So. All right, so I'm going to take now and just, I'll have you pour that. Is that hot? Is that too hot or anything? Just pour that right over here, and don't forget to smile.
Hey.
It's, you know, dumpster and smile, folks, because you never know when the camera's on you. So it's like, oh, you know. Fantastic.
Oh, man, that looks good.
Does that look good? I love it. Let's move that out of the way, and I'm going to have you stay right there because you can start stirring that baby.
Oh.
And we need one more egg fresh from the Stralini chicken in the back. Burk, burk. There we go. I've seen bunnies here. I have.
It's not a bunny egg. I know that for a fact.
Oh.
They're much smaller.
Yes. Oh, that looks good. So we want this to be nice and wet, per se. You want it to be soft and yummy and not too wet, not too dry, as Mama Bear would say, just right.
Mm-hmm.
All right. I think we're getting there. The only thing I'm looking for is my, here it is. Here it is. Dun, 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 dun. How does that feel? Is that fun?
Yeah, this is great.
Does it feel schmooshy?
Yeah, I'm a kid again on the beach.
I know. All righty, my friend. You may go ahead and just pour that right
pour
in there.
Right in there.
And don't forget to smile. And yeah, there it goes.
Like this.
Woo! Because if you smile, and maybe if something went wrong, and if you're smiling, they don't know.
They're not going to look, right?
That's right.
Spread it out?
Yep.
How's that?
Oh my gosh, that's gorgeous. Was that fun?
Carol, I was born to do this.
You were born to do that.
Thanks
absolutely.
For coming and calling.
Well, I appreciate you being here, and
right.
You're always willing to cook with me. So
absolutely.
Thank you, my brochen.
Rock
up. Rock. Shango, everybody. Shango. Woo! Fantastic. Now I'm going to pass this off to our magic elves. And they're, isn't that pretty? I'm just so excited. Guess what? We're going to eat good today. Ah. Okay, my friends. So, friends, so what did I tell you? Your homework project. You know, you're going to have all that good stuff kind of set out so that you know what you're doing. Let's see. Is that too hot? Can I handle? Okay, you got that? Got that? Okay, great, great. What's next? Ooh, broccoli cheese casserole. I'm telling you. Okay, so I'm going to do, which pan am I going to do? I'm going to do this one here. So this is a recipe that my mother... This is one of my mother's recipes, and she, every time she made it and every time I ate it, it wasn't Thanksgiving unless I had this. So it was pretty dang cool. So the nice thing about this, it gives you a green vegetable, and you can add, you know, and it has cauliflower in it too. And it uses a lot of classic techniques. So if you've ever heard of the wonderful chef Julia Child, then I always like to say this is classic French, okay? And I can't say classic French without doing classic French, okay? So everybody out there, you got that? Classic French, all right? And the reason I say that is because we're gonna make a bechamel sauce. So bechamel is one of the classic sauces in cooking. And that probably just rinsed for later if I need it. So yeah, thank you, my dear. Thank you so much. So what I'm doing, with a bechamel, you will start with equal amounts of fat and flour. Now for this, we're using butter. I'm using unsalted butter, and then I'm using flour. So you just wait for that to come to the melting stage, and then we'll add the flour to it. So in Cajun and Creole cooking, just a real quickie thing, which is perfect to do for Thanksgiving leftovers. You can make a turkey gumbo. You can do a turkey, turkey broth with the bones, and then you can make a turkey gumbo for later. So in Cajun and Creole, usually Cajun roux are made with fat and flour, but the fat is vegetable oil. And in Creole cooking, it's usually bacon fat. So it just depends on the style of cooking. So there we go. And what I love about a bechamel is that it's just super simple. The classic French version makes it with the butter and flour, and you cook it to the blonde stage, which is just, there's no color. It is a blonde, golden, light golden color. And it thickens your sauce. It thickens the milk. Now with a Cajun and Creole gravy, you take it to new heights. You cook it a little bit longer, depending on what you're using it for. You can make a light roux, a medium roux, or a dark roux. So the medium roux is about a color of a copper penny. And that is perfect for etouffees, making gumbos, whatever. So that just takes the roux a little bit farther in color, so you're just cooking it a little bit longer. And it also not only colors the dish of what you're doing, if it's a deepened color, but it also, it has less thickening power, just FYI. So the more you cook the flour, the less thickening power it has, but it will still thicken it. So with a blonde roux, you're gonna get a gorgeous thickened roux. So I remember helping mom with this, I think, and what I loved about it was just so much fun and easy to do. And then I remember shopping at Dillard's with her, and there was the clothing lines, and it was called Bechamel, so we loved that. So, you know, food shopping, you know, I was always excited to do that. So I love shopping with my mom. Ah, that's great. So that's going to come up to a boil, and when it does, it's going to thicken up, and then that'll take a minute or two. You want to cook it just to get that flour taste out of it. I will go ahead and add salt and pepper to it right now. You don't need a lot. There we go. Oh, it is truly magic. I think a bechamel sauce is magic because look at how quick that's working. This is the kind of magic that you can eat, which is my favorite kind of magic. So there you go. Look at that. Oh, again, the dishes for Thanksgiving to me are pretty simple. The most important ingredient, it's love. All right, now I'll add some Swiss cheese. This is kind of different because I don't think many people associate Thanksgiving with Swiss cheese a lot. But yeah, it does. It, again, remember, it's the little side dishes. If you're going to a friend's house and you're gonna bring something, you know, this is where you can get creative, and this is your creative spin, and it becomes your own. So, very nice. Oh, I love licking the bowl on this one. Just make sure you cool it off first. Oh, and there you go. Bechamel. Classic French. All righty. So there we go. Now, I have made my life really simple. They sell now bags of broccoli and cauliflower that are ready to go, and you can steam them in the bag in the microwave, and that's exactly what I did. So I just put the bag in the microwave for about, you know, 3 to 4 minutes. My mom often, for convenience, would use frozen broccoli and cauliflower, which is perfectly fine. I've done it that way, and I've cooked it with fresh broccoli and cauliflower that I cut myself, and I did all that. Folks, when you're doing Thanksgiving 101, make life easy on yourself. Honestly, you know, there's no shame in using convenience products for this stuff because you've got a lot to do. And the more easier that you can make it on yourself, the better. Ah, how does that look? Ooh. Okay, now the bestest part of this recipe are the big chunky bread cubes that go on top. And I've pre-buttered them. I've just put them in a big bag, and I put some melted butter on top of them, and I'm just gonna adorn the top. And again, they're big, chunky bread cubes, and that was my favorite part. And you could do smaller bread cubes if you want to. This is just a good old mushy white bread, as my mom would call it. But she also used big bread cubes like this on top of her zucchini casserole, which is like so good. So there you go. Now this takes, again, about 350 in the oven, 375 for about 20 to 30 minutes. And I think that's the best part about these side dishes is that once your turkey's out, put all your side dishes in and voila, with the magic of television, they're done. There you go. Oh, how's everybody doing? How am I doing on time, everybody? Good, good, okay, haven't lost my microphone yet, but I'm working on it, I'm working on it. And you know what, I know probably a lot of you have questions out there. So I think what I'll do, you know, ask your questions in the comments later. After we're done, I'm going to go ahead and look at all those questions, and I promise that I will answer each and every one of you. Because number one, I want to make sure that you have the best holiday of your life. And I love questions, and I've got the time. So I would love to know what your questions are. Okay, so I'm just going to find, here we go. There we go. So guess what we're going to do? Cranberry sauce. Yay! I don't know, I'm excited about all these dishes, really. There's not one that's more my favorite than the other because I think they all just kind of work in harmony. I think a good Thanksgiving balance is where you have things that work in harmony. So for this dish, I will need some water. Here we go. I need about 1 cup of water and 1 cup of sugar. And we have adapted these recipes throughout the years, many of them. And this year, I think we're gonna try using less sugar in this one, maybe even a half a cup, because we like things on the tart side. So if you want to just, you know, pare down that sugar, that's certainly fine. I'm a recipe developer too. I have enjoyed developing recipes for companies and organizations throughout the years. Recently, I did one for a stevia sweetener. And I know there's a lot of sweeteners out there, but I actually grew stevia in the backyard in Texas. And it's amazing how that leaf really can taste really, really sweet. You just put one little leaf in a tea and it makes it taste really sweet. So, you know, that would be one that I might recommend. I truly, in my cooking, I like to use basic, straightforward products as much as I can because I feel that the classic flavor, you know, this is Thanksgiving, this is your treat, go for it. So there we go. Now I'm going to bring that up to a boil. It just has to simmer for about 5 minutes or so until it kind of makes that nice little sugar syrup. Okay. And then now we can talk cranberries. Now, many of you are probably thinking, well, you know, I've got, you know, the can. I always do canned cranberries every year. Maybe you're a jellied canned cranberry lover. Maybe you like the jellied, or, you know, the jellied or the, what is the other one? Like a whole berry. And that's fine. If you don't have time to make it, I still love you. It's okay. But what I love about this is that when you make homemade cranberry sauce, it is just the icing on the cake. It's the jewel in the crown. And if you wanna help your family or friends and you're gonna bring something, then do cranberry sauce. And I betcha everybody will love you to death, okay? So I'm just gonna pour them in here so you can see what they look like. But all you have to do, and I've rinsed this in the bag and just kind of drained it. There are holes in here, so just FYI, that's why it looks wet. So you want to pick through the cranberries. If there's any soft ones, get rid of those. If there's any little stems, get rid of those. And every year I love to bounce the cranberries because they're also known as bounce berries. So it's fun to just kind of give them a bounce. And if they are bouncy, then you know that they are nice and ripe. Alrighty, so here we go. This is a beautiful little sugar syrup here, equal amounts of sugar and water. Okay, there we go. So we'll add the cranberries to the sugar syrup. Stay by the pan and keep an eye on it, because in a little bit they're gonna start popping. And it's that fine line of too warm or too cool of a temperature. As Mama Bear says, you want it just right. So just, this is a great one you can kind of babysit. You can have a glass of milk and cookies on the side of you if you want to. I find that when I'm cooking Thanksgiving dinner, what helps me as a cook to, you know, enjoy the process is that I have little treats throughout the day. For example, if I'm getting the bread ready for the stuffing, I'll make myself some toast. Maybe I'm doing the mashed potatoes. So today I put a little bit of mashed potato in a bowl and I put a little, you know, of toppings on it, and that was my little treat. So I think that the cook's treat is very vital to Thanksgiving, and very good. Uh-oh, I'm moving the table. All right, so there it goes. They're starting to crack and sound wonderful. All right, here is my orange. You can use a microplane to get the zest off of this. And as I discover, I think my microplane is still at home, but that's okay, because you can take a vegetable peeler and just get the outside of the peel without the pith part. You don't want to go too deep because that can be a little bit bitter, but you'll need some of that peel to give it the aromatic touch that it needs. All right, very good. So I will go ahead and just chop this up with my knife. If you're gonna do a chop cut, put your hand on the top and just work your knife back and forth. And that just releases all of that yummy perfume and wonderful flavor. This is, you know, Thanksgiving is almost like turkey therapy. I recently visited Cornwell's Turkeyville in Marshall, Michigan. I hadn't been there in years. And I wondered why everyone there was so happy. And when I got a whiff of the turkeys roasting in the oven, I knew why. Because they actually do turkey dinners almost every single day. So I grew up with Thanksgiving Day being almost everyday occurrence as a norm. So that was very exciting. So I will say that Thanksgiving is kind of like a great therapeutic. It's therapeutic. And when you got great neighbors, that if you forget ingredients or don't have something, that's, God bless neighbors. All right, oh, that's looking great. So this only takes about, you know, 5 minutes or so until those berries burst and they look delicious. So hopefully y'all can see that. Yay, we can see. I might even move it over a little bit more. Maybe, there we go. Alrighty, so we will need some orange juice. So quite simply, this recipe is very straightforward. You don't need a lot. You definitely change it up however you like. You could do grapefruit zest or grapefruit juice or lemon or lime. I will use some of this orange juice to flavor this up along with the zest. And anything that's left, I call cook's treat. So remember to leave yourself something yummy to enjoy. Honestly, I have to stay away from the turkey when it gets out of the oven, because by the time it gets to the table, there's no leg left. Just saying. I kind of taste it every now and then. Okay. Oh, look at that. It's bubbling over. It's beautiful. Okay, folks. This is basically done. It's basically done. So I will go ahead and pour in that yummy juice and add the zest. And voila, you will have the most amazing cranberry sauce. And we're gonna put this in a cute little bowl for you. All right, as again, simple, simple, simple. We're in the home stretch, you guys. We really only have a few things to do. And as you can see, the more you have it staged, remember, kids, tape your mom, dad, aunt, uncle, grandma, grandpa. If they get everything mise en place, you know, everything out, then just you be the TV person and you just tell them to go. And I bet you probably know how to edit it and put music on it too. Mm-hmm. Yep, way better than I do. So that's your homework. Just do one recipe. And I tell you, those are precious memories that are etched on your heart forever. Alrighty, folks. There we go. So I'm gonna put this right over here, and then you can, we'll put this in some sort of a glass bowl of some sort once we get everything going. Where am I, folks? We're doing one, I'm just counting. We're doing one, two, three, four. We've got four things to go, so not too bad. Just remember, this is Thanksgiving. Okay, mashed potatoes. All right. So for the mashed potatoes, I do have to admit that one year, you know, it's kind of like the dressing. Sometimes I hit or miss and I fail miserably on the mashed potatoes. Once I wasn't thinking about it and I put too much liquid in it and it was basically mashed potato soup. So we served it in bowls that year. Okay, I just, you know, you think I'm good at measuring, you know, just by the fly. Yeah, no, doesn't always happen. Okay. So here we go. So I promise not to put too much liquid in this one. So mashed potatoes, you know, are pretty straightforward. They're a great thing to do, great thing to teach the kiddos, and just a great thing all in all. So let's see, here we go. When I first moved to Texas and I first started teaching cooking classes, we were made friends with the most wonderful families and people. One of them, her name was Elizabeth, and I hope she's watching today, and if she's not, I'll definitely send this to her. But we actually went over to her house once and she cooked for us, and it was so amazing just to sit down and watch her cook. But here is her secret for really good mashed potatoes. And the best part about it is that they heat up beautifully. So you can make these the day ahead and they're absolutely wonderful. So Elizabeth, this one's for you. So what you do is you get your potatoes, you peel them and slice them or quarter them and cook them in water to cover for about, you know, 20 minutes or so until they're nice and tender. Then we're going to add our milk to it, and I'm not going to add too much yet because Lord knows that I love the liquid, you know. And then I'll add butter to this. And I love this little teeny tiny mashed potato masher. I like it better than the large size, probably because it fits my hand well, like a good magic wand. You know, you gotta be comfortable with it. But it works great for potatoes, sweet potatoes, guacamole. And if you want to use it on your cranberries to get them a little bit more pulverized up, it works great with that. So you're gonna find your special dishes that you love. And it's funny, we always serve the cranberry sauce in the same bowl every year. I'm sure you know exactly what I'm talking about. But because we moved, we can't find it, so we're in big doo-doo trouble. Anyway, there you go. Now, so after the butter and the milk, then you add the magic ingredients, which are cream cheese and sour cream. Okay? And there you go. Good stuff. I'll add a little salt and pepper to that. And just mash it up. Then it's ready to go into a casserole dish or whatever, and you can keep it, you can warm it up. If you put it in a glass bowl, you can warm it up beautifully. Or sometimes what I like to do if I'm cooking the potatoes, I will take the potatoes out of the water and I'll leave that simmering water in there, and then I'll take a stainless steel bowl and I'll put it on. When I make my mashed potatoes, I'll put them in that stainless steel bowl and I'll put it on top of the boiling water. So it's like a double boiler. And then you've got your, it's keeping it warm without drying it out. Okay, I'm gonna hand this off to the magic elves, who are going to do a beautiful job of getting this nice and what's the word? Smooth, much smoother than I. All right, there you go. Okay, what's next? Turkey, okay. when I get the turkey out, we have to take a little, what is this, seventh inning stretch. So I'm going to give you guys a fun little seventh inning stretch thing. We're going to do your best Julia Child impression, okay? So, very good. Okay. Oh, yeah. Oh, almost forgot. We're not going to do the turkey yet. We're going to do this one. Ha ha. So anyway, this is the seventh inning stretch. On the count of three, all of you at home, I want you to give me your best bon appetit in your Julia Child accent, okay? And I will give you a little practice. I'll say it myself, and you can do your impression however you like, but bless her. I love that lady. She's amazing. So, bon appetit. Okay, you got it. I'll do one more. Bon appetit. All right, so on the count of three, we're going to do our bon appetit. You ready? And a one, and a two, and a three. Bon appetit. See, didn't that make you just free your soul? Didn't that free your soul? I love it. Good job, you guys. Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. I got to wash my hands, as my Grandma Gertrude would say. And you know what? I'm going to need help for this one, too. We don't have a lot of people here today, so I'm just kind of counting on the people that can help me, because it's fun. It's fun to grab somebody to help. Shango, hi there. Do you like bacon?
I love bacon.
I'm so glad you said that, because I do too. And that's the first ingredient, is bacon. And I think there's something to it. When you start cooking bacon, yeah, that's the best. All right, my friends, so here is, you can grab one of these, and just kind of pop the end to bring those open. Push the end in. Ah, it's magic. You know, you guys think you're cool with your stuff, honeys. I got to show you something. We've got a lot of fun in store, you know, for the future, because cooking is magical. So every now and then, just give those a little turn. And, you know, as many cooking demonstrations that I've done all across the country, the moment that I start cooking bacon or smoked sausage or onions, yeah. So that's the way to get your whole family involved. And I'm going to tell you a little secret. The recipe, this is, we're making succotash. And it's a very traditional dish, although we're going to add some twists to it. But the bacon is supposed to be chopped. But nobody needs to know that, because really you need it for the flavor. And yes, you can chop it up and put it in the finished dish. But it honestly can be a cook's treat, don't you think? I mean, nobody needs to know it's in there. So anyway, if you leave it whole like that, there you go. How's that look?
Fantastic.
We want it to be GBD, golden brown and delicious.
Alrighty.
Yep.
I'll do my best.
All right. Fantastic. So I'm going to need some sage too. So for this dish, it's a classic mixture of corn and beans. And I use lima beans for this. And I know a lot of you are probably thinking, lima beans. Oh, sorry. Sorry, mic person, I didn't mean to scream. It was a little loud, I know. But this is going to be, let me get my little scissors here. This is going to be good stuff. So we're going to go a little less traditional. We have the lima beans, and they are so delicious, but you can use edamame, which is frozen. You can get it, the edamame, in little plastic bags, and you're good to go. All right, very good. That's almost done. Mm-hmm. Okay, boy, the smoke is getting to me. Yeah, it's like onions too. When you're cutting onions, have you ever made you cry?
Every time. Yeah. Got a good tip?
Yes.
What is it?
I do. I've got a couple of them.
We all want to know. Mm.
Well, I've heard the thing where you put a match in your mouth, you know, and that helps. Or you put a slice of bread in your mouth. Now, I've tried that. You know, where you hold a slice of bread in your mouth. Now, I went through the whole loaf. It didn't work. I don't know why. Anyway, I do have onion goggles at home. But also, if you rinse it before you cut it, it's a good idea. And keep the root end on, that also helps it too.
Oh, really?
Yep.
I've always cut that off. I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. And my mentor, Martin Yan, always says, never form an emotional bond with your oven. Yeah. Oven?
With your onion.
With your onion.
That might have been one of my problems as well.
Yeah.
I used to take them out to dinner and everything before.
Really? Wow. Shenga, what's your favorite part about Thanksgiving?
Oh, family. Family. Love being with the family.
Awesome.
Love cooking. Cooking is love, Carol. That's how I see it. Cooking is love.
Oh. Is there a particular favorite dish that you and your family love?
Oh, boy. We just have the usual, green bean casserole, the mashed potatoes and gravy, the turkey stuffing. My mom makes homemade stuffing, puts it in the turkey.
Oh, yes.
Yep.
Oh, fantastic. All right, you can put those on there now, and I'll give you the onions.
Please.
Yep, just right in this little paper towel. And that's for you and I later. How about that?
Beautiful. Sorry.
Yes, this is great. So I'll give you the onions. Oh, sorry. Did I get you? Did I get you?
That's all
sorry.
Right. I've been burned before.
Oh, my goodness. I'm going to add the sage in there, too, because why not? And I'm going to get you a spoon that'll be a little easier to stir with. Here you go, my friend.
Thank you.
Yes. I hope I didn't get you.
No, we're good. We're good.
Okay. Oh, that's so good. So, this is an excellent recipe.
Oh, it smells great.
That smell good with that sage.
Oh,
good stuff.
Fantastic.
I made this for dinner one night for Kurt and I, and we literally ate the whole pan over rice, and it was so good. So you could literally have this as a meatless meal option if you wanted to.
You could smell this right now. It is unbelievable. Oh,
the bacon,
sage and everything. Oh.
Awesome.
Golly.
How many pies do you normally have when you are with your family?
My mom makes a pumpkin pie, and my brother makes a delicious chocolate pecan pie.
Oh, my goodness.
Unbelievable.
That
brother, rock on, man. You are awesome. Mom, too.
That sounds
so
great.
So good. Yep.
Oh, my goodness. Right, now we'll add the corn and the lima beans. Eat your lima beans, everybody. Do it. All right, look at that. Look at that. Beautiful. You know, I'm getting more relaxed because we've gotten only 24 recipes to go. You know?
Home stretch.
On the home stretch, yeah. I mean, literally, if you get yourself set up, it's really not too bad. Now, I'm going to save these two for us. I will put some of this bacon in there. I love to use my kitchen scissors for everything.
Me too.
These are my mentors. Kitchen scissors, Martin Yan, if Yan can cook. I have to give thanks to him and his family for just
Does he know
so
you
well.
Have them?
I don't think so. I don't know. Who knows? We'll see. And all of my mentors, too, and my bishop and Joe and his family and my family and my husband's family. I mean, I'm just so thankful. What are you thankful for this Thanksgiving?
Oh, friends and family. Still.
Yes.
We're still here. We're still here. We've survived so far. It's been good.
We're going to make it. We're going to make it. And God bless you all. That's great.
My mom is going to be 95 at the end of this year. Very blessed.
Holy smokes.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Happy birthday, Mom.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. Well, I know she's proud of you. And
she would love this, I'll tell you that.
Would she? Yeah. You'll have to make it for her. So. Well, we're done. I'm going to give him a hand.
Yay.
It's
Thank
magic.
You. This
you,
is great.
You not only create it's magic with your hands, you can create magic.
It's magic how it all comes together. Culinary magic, right?
Ooh, I love it. Ooh. I love it. Okay, hearts, everybody. Fantastic. So
good.
I guess we could just leave that one right there.
All right.
What's next on my agenda? Turkey. And now I'm on turkey, I think. Okay, I'm on turkey. Thank you so much.
You are welcome.
All right. So I'm going to put this over here, and then I'll put this over here. We're going to find something to put these in for presentation. And then, so we've got turkey gravy, and then we're in good shape. And hopefully I'm doing good on time. Okay, very good. So I'm gonna make life easy for the turkey because I want you guys to keep it easy for the turkey. So this is about a 10-pound turkey. And what's nice about it is that a 10-pound turkey is really easy to handle. It's easy to wrangle. Did I say hangle? Anyway, it's easy to handle. And if you've never done Thanksgiving before, don't try to get like a 40-pound turkey or a 24-pound turkey because it might intimidate you. So get a small one. You could get two small ones. That's fine. They'll cook really fast. So what you do is you thaw it out according to package directions in the refrigerator. There is a quick thaw method, but you'll have to Google all of that and see that. But then you make sure you take out the neck that's in the cavity of the bird, and then you take out the giblets, which are right here in the front. Okay, now just to make life easy, I already done that, and I've had this little container around, and I think I'm scaring everybody with it, which is kind of fun. But this is the giblets that come inside the little sack. So there is heart and the gizzard and the liver. Don't forget the liver. All right, and you can use those in your gravy if you want to. I usually don't. If I have friends that are coming over, I'll cook that and they can enjoy that. But the liver tends to make the giblet gravy kind of cloudy. So I just saw a video with Jacques Pepin, and I noticed that he sautéed his in butter and had it with a glass of wine, and that was his cook's treat. So go for it. So what I like to do for the turkey is just take some olive oil and just baste the top of it so that it doesn't dry out and it gives it a nice sheen. And then I'll put you can put fresh herbs or dried herbs on top. I usually do dried herbs because it just cooks beautifully. And it takes a little bit longer for dried herbs to cook. So that's, you know, a nice thing. I remember my first Thanksgiving, and we actually had like one of those huge 80s video cameras. So I know it's around somewhere at home, but it was me making my first turkey, and I really didn't know what I was doing back then, 33 years ago. So I was just slapping Crisco on the turkey with my hands, because that's what I thought you did. And my mother just thought that was hilarious. So there you go. But I don't do that anymore. I use olive oil. So we're going to put salt and pepper on top. And then I've got a little bit of seasoning. Yes, this is, you can use herbs, seasonings, whatever. One of my go-to seasonings, believe it or not, is a steak seasoning. And I just put it on anything, anything and everything. It's just really good. And then I have an Italian seasoning. So I just like to keep this part simple. Now, you can put your stuffing inside of the turkey if you want to. Just make sure you cool it down first, okay? Make your stuffing, cool it down. Because putting the warm stuffing inside a cool bird, the bacteria can multiply. So just do that. And don't overstuff it. Just put enough in there so it can expand. What I usually do is put oranges or citrus or lemon inside and some fresh herbs from my garden. I actually brought some bay leaves from my garden from Texas. And I'd like for, every now and then I'll pick off a leaf for spaghetti sauce, whatever. But I'll put that in the middle. So there you go. And there's your turkey. You roast it according to the package directions. In general, it's 325 for about, 10 to 13 minutes per pound. And then with the magic of television, Shango, say ooh. Ah. Ah. Is that gorgeous? Yay! I'm so excited, and I just can't hide it. Okay, that's the main event, my friends. You want to make sure that you let that rest for about 15 minutes before you carve it. All the juices from the inside will go to the outside. It'll be in great shape. Alrighty. So now I'm going to get my gravy done. Gravy, gravy. So, again, when you cook and you're taping your family at home cooking, you stage things. And we've staged this, clearly. I actually roasted it in a different pan. So this one looks really pretty and nice, and that's all well and good. So I will show you what the drippings look like, because we're going to make the gravy. We're going to do it the best way that we can, because Carol Ritchie just realized that I don't have any flour. Oh, well, that's okay. You know what? It's not the end of the world. So this is what the drippings look like out of the thing. And I'm actually leaving all of this in the Cool Whip containers. Yes, I am, because I'm sure you guys do this at home. Make sure, though, if you use a different container, make sure you label it, folks. Make sure you label it so you know what it is, okay? Because you'll be in for a rude awakening. We all do it, okay? So there's many ways that you can thicken the gravy. You can do, you can put that in there and simmer it down and then add shaken flour and water, or you can make a roux. And I think flour is coming from the magical kitchen. So I'm gonna put a little bit of butter in there and we'll make a roux just like we did for the bechamel. It is magic. God bless you. Thank you. Alrighty. So we'll get that going. And wow, I mean, this is so nice and gelatinous. It's pretty much, you know, ready to go, that the turkey goodness. Years ago on my cooking show, I had the Rockettes on. And they were amazing. Now, they came on the beginning of the show and they had their outfits on, but we were not allowed to cook with them in their outfits, which clearly makes sense, you know, because they're special outfits. So afterwards, we did the commercial break and they were able to change and cook with me. And we were making cookies together. And I remember one of the Rockettes said that the drippings were her favorite part of Thanksgiving, that they keep it in a secret bowl in the refrigerator. So whenever they need a little spoonful of drippings, that's their little treat. So how about that? So who knew that Rockettes lived on that kind of power? Thanksgiving is such a fun time. And I love, love, love living in this magical community of Colon, Michigan. We really came here, you know, we never really thought about living here. My husband visited Colon, Michigan often with his grandfather years ago. And I grew up, we both grew up in Battle Creek, which isn't too far from Colon. But Colon really captured our heart. And I will say that the people here in this community have captured our hearts as well. It's just, I know the best is yet to come. There are so many exciting things coming down the pipe. So just be waiting for them. They're coming. All right, so then you're gonna add that yummy gelatinous turkey drippings. And then what I do is I take the turkey neck, which is right in here, and I'll leave it in here just so that you guys can see it. But I take that turkey neck and I will simmer it on the stove when the turkey's in the oven, and then it just smells your kitchen really nice. And then you can use that for your gravy or your stuffing or whatever you need it for. So this is gonna thicken up. And this is gonna be our gravy. So I'm just gonna put this off to the side and then we'll have our pumpkin pie. And then we're done. But then I've got surprises, so you have to stay tuned. Okay, so let's see. I'm gonna put this in the corner here and I'm gonna have you stir it. So if you'll hold it for a second. Thank you, ma'am. Okay, great. So I'm gonna just put that on. There we go. And if you need to turn it down, you can just turn it off right there. All right, so for the pie, I think I'm just gonna bring this all over here. How about that? That'll make life easy. Okay, fantastic. Alrighty, so pumpkin pie is a crowning touch for this dish, for this whole meal. So the pumpkin pie is actually, and that's if you needed it to make it thicker. The pumpkin pie is simple to do. So assign this one to one of the young ones and then watch them and have fun with the process and encourage them. That's what it's all about. So what you'll need for this is your pie shell. I like to use the kind that, you know, if you're not making it yourself, which is totally fine, the ones that you can put in the pan and then flute the edges however you like. Those are beautiful. And they work well. Make life easy for yourself for this. Okay, great. Here's my bowl and a whisk. All right, so for this dish, we have everybody's favorite cream of condensed milk. Wait a minute, that's not what it's called. Condensed milk. I was thinking cream of chicken soup, but that's something completely different. All right, so we've got the condensed milk. We have the pumpkin pie spices, or you can use cinnamon and clove and nutmeg. Two eggs, two more eggs fresh from the stirrellini chicken. And then we'll add pumpkin pie puree, which is canned. And as you can see, this is one of those dumpster and smiles. So you can, that would be a perfect photo op to get with your kids. And they'll be happy to pose for the camera. At least hopefully they will. I'm going to use my whisk on this one. My dear friend Cindy started a whisk collection for me. So I actually have the Whisk Movement, which is my blog site, the Whisk Movement. And it's a lot of fun. I always find that maybe if you collect something, that's kind of like your little signature. So I have over 50 whisks from her, and she's amazing. And Linda, her friend, I mean, they've been my assistants for years. And I always have to shout out to my BFF, Becky. Love you. So there we go. So look at how nice that is. I've had many a pie at her house. There we go. We call it first dessert and second dessert. All right, and then just pour that in there. And then you bake this until it is set in the center. And if I can get it going, I want to dip some strawberries. Well, that would be nice. Dip some pecans for the top. If I don't quite get there, it's okay, because I want to make sure that I respect your time, you guys, today. But you can do chocolate-dipped pecans on the top there, and there's your pumpkin pie. So very good. How are we doing on time, my friends? We doing good? Doing good. Okay. Well, again, remember, as I'm just kind of getting set up, we're going to put all the dishes on the table here so that you can see. And leave your questions in the comment section. Later on tonight, I will go through those and I'll be happy to answer all of your questions. But what's exciting is that we're going to have a little magic interlude. And so I think I'm going to throw it to an incredible magician, and his name is John Stirrellini.
Well, hello. I have a classic effect in magic, one of my favorites, and I hope you guys enjoy this. This is the classic bottle and glass trick. Glass and bottle trick. Bottle and glass trick. There we go. Now for this effect, we also need two tubes. This tube goes over the glass, and this tube whoops. Let me explain. I always keep an extra bottle on hand just in case of breakage or a really rough crowd. Now this tube goes over this bottle. The trick is to make the bottle and glass change places. Watch. Done. And I'll prove it. The glass is now a bottle, yep, and the bottle is now a glass, yeah. And now the difficult part, to make them go back. Watch. Done. Bottle is now a glass is now a bottle, a classic bottle and glass trick. Yeah, I know what you guys are thinking. You wanted to see something like this, where the glass turns into a bottle turns into a glass turns into a bottle, and bottle turns into glass. And that is a classic bottle and glass trick. Now the cool thing, this will also work with only one tube, where one bottle becomes a glass, one glass turns into a bottle, and we have an extra bottle right there. Once again, just in case of breakage, and we'll try that once more. Glass becomes a bottle becomes a glass, and I don't know if I mentioned, but I keep an extra one on hand just in case. And we're going to do that with this tube, where the glass will turn into a bottle. Bottle will turn into a glass, and you know the story. Party at Stirrellini's. And again, glass turns into a bottle, and a bottle turns into a glass, and yep, there's one more right there. I don't know about you guys, but I'm getting awfully thirsty. Once more. Woo! Another bottle. Oh, but we're not done yet, folks. You guys have been fantastic. I hope you enjoyed my interlude. Happy Thanksgiving. Cheers.
Oh my gosh. Well, folks, this is a little bit about what my life has been like for the last couple of months. And it's exciting because there's always magic in the air around here. And I really hope that maybe some of you have been tuning in to my daily cheer segments. I hope so, because those have been fun to present. I just basically tape them all over colon. So let's see. So basically, my life every Monday is here at Cerlini's. They have their mayhem. There's other magicians in town, which are so much fun. There's so much excitement that is building. So if you've been looking for some cheer, well, you can find it right here in this fantastic community. And I do have to give a little plug. One of my side hustles is that I'm an independent consultant for Scout and Cellar Wine. What's cool about that is that it's clean crafted wine. There are no chemicals, no synthetic pesticides, no added sugars. It is just really good wine, the way it's supposed to be, from the fields to the farmers to the wine families to your bottle to your door. It's shipped right to your door. So here in the Magic Capital, we do elevated bottles. So I just thought I'd show you how I elevate my bottle. Isn't that cool? So that's how we do it in the Magic Capital. So let me know if you're interested in doing a private tasting or a virtual tasting. And I would love to educate, give you the education on that. And it's so much fun. So just send me a private message. All right, my friends, look at this. We have, so I think I've got everything. Is there any? Oh, yes, yes, yes. Ooh. So I have some little bit of whipped cream. And you know, I think when it comes to the pie, I think that, you know, how much whipped cream you put on it just depends on how you like it. Some people like a little pie with their whipped cream. You know how that goes. There you go. And I'm going to work on doing some chocolate dip pecans. All you have to do is do the dark chocolate morsels, melt them, and then you half dip a pecan half into it, and you're in good shape. So that, I'm going to show you guys that finished dish later. You'll be able to see pictures of that. And so we have all these great dishes coming in. This is amazing. This is really amazing, you guys. So I want you to see how beautiful all these wonderful dishes are. And I just want to tell you how excited I am to be here with you guys today. And I hope, you know, you enjoyed this session. I hope that you share it afterwards. There's going to be the, you know, taped version. Please share that with your family and friends. Look at all this food we've made in a short period of time. And the best part of it is that it's all easy to do. Here's your grand turkey. Here is the succotash, which is so easy to make. Homemade cranberry sauce with the orange zest and orange juice. Pumpkin pie, yummy, yummy. And apple stuffing, Michigan style. And delicious, creamy mashed potatoes. And a gorgeous corn casserole with the cheese and the bell peppers on top. Your nice thickened gravy. And my mother's broccoli and cheese cauliflower casserole with a Swiss cheese bechamel sauce. So anyway, I don't think I've forgotten anything. I hope. And it's, if you do, it's okay, because somebody always forgets something. So I want to thank you so much from the Magic Capital of the World here at Cerlini's Cedar. I'm going to leave you with a very, very special surprise. My friend Tam, she has an excellent CD with holiday music on it, and she is going to sing us one of the songs from this CD. It is available for sale. We'll make sure that we get you that information. I'd like to thank the Cerlini's for letting me tape this here today. They are amazing people and wonderful for the community. And if you're interested in anything, just give a holler. So mwah, God bless. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody. And I love being here in Colon, Michigan, the magic capital of the world. Take it away, Tammy.
Jingle bell.